America's reckoning with racism has prompted a number of apologies, including one from the creator of the popular sitcom Friends. Marta Kaufman is now apologizing for the lack of diversity on her long-running show. Speaking on a virtual panel interview, she said, quote, "Sorry, I just wish I knew then what I know now. I would have made very different decisions." And she goes on to say, "I mean, we've always encouraged people of diversity in our company, but I didn't do enough. And now all I can think about is what can I do?" Friends has long been criticized for its lack of diversity, even by its cast members. David Schwimmer, who played Ross, has said that he was well aware of the lack of diversity and that he campaigned for years to have Ross date women of color. One of his girlfriends on the show was Aisha Tyler. She had a recurring role that you will probably remember as Dr. Charlie Wheeler, who was Joey's and then Ross's girlfriend. And Aisha is joining me now to talk about this. Aisha, thank you so much for being here.
It's a pleasure. Good to see you.
So when you saw Marta Kaufman or you heard of her apology, what did you think?
Well, look, this has been a conversation about Friends for, you know, decades. I mean, since the show was on the air. And I think my appearance on the show was a part of a concerted effort to diversify very late in the show's life. And I came on season 9. And I really appreciate what Marta Kaufman said. And I'm glad that she's making this, you know, an attempt at a full-throated apology. She's an incredibly smart lady and, you know, has obviously accomplished a lot, but I think she probably did know then what she knows now. And I think it points to a larger issue, not just in Hollywood, but culturally, this kind of, it's the casual racism of apathy, which is that, well, I know this is going on, but it's not really my problem. Or, you know, I'm just hiring people that I know, people that I relate to, people that I connect with no thought about the fact that most of those people are gonna look and sound and have a similar experience to yours. And even in Hollywood, where there was this narrative that shows with black leads don't work or interracial relationships are a little, you know, too risque, it's not enough. We've been hearing it every day. It's not enough to not be a racist. You have to be actively anti-racist and making the kinds of choices that are not just representative, but compelling and interesting and tell new and different stories. And so, I mean, I really think that show was just a function of Marta's own personal experiences. And she was just telling the stories that she knew. And they just, you know, happened to be about white people.
When you look, as you talk about there are opportunities for anti-racism in Hollywood, is there anything in particular when you think of the shows that we see now? And, you know, it feels like there's so many more, right? Or these limited series or movies. What opportunities kind of, I guess, in a very tangible way, do you say there, that's ripe for showing people different kinds of people, different experiences? What do you think?
Well, that's a really good question. You know, I think that there has been a move to tell a broader swath of stories with a broader swath and a more complex group of actors and stories and characters. I'm just thinking right now of the second season of Homecoming, where the lead is Janelle Monáe, and last season it was Julia Roberts. I mean, there are a million examples, you know, out there, and I think that there's a growing move to diversify. But I want to be really clear. They're still using this term in Hollywood, like, we want a diverse lead. And there's always been a code for like a non-white lead, like a diverse lead or an urban lead. These are just Americans. And I think we need to get past this idea that we're doing someone a favor when we decide to cast someone who's outside of what's been for so long in Hollywood, the cultural norm, and just start talking about telling American stories. It's really important to tell black stories, but that's because they're American stories. And so, I mean, we have a lot of work to do because it should not just be that, you know, black stories are stories about the inner city or stories about struggling, you know, through poverty. I mean, these stories are diverse American stories with a lot of complexity. And I think we're still stuck in the idea that we're going to step outside of what's normal to pick a diverse lead rather than just continually working hard to tell great, new, urgent American stories that come from a variety of areas. I think we have a lot of black creators out there now, which is great. We've got shows with, you know, predominantly black casts, and that's also great. But we've got to stop thinking about the idea that the norm is the kind of the middle-class white American story, and everything else is alternative. And I think that that's going to mean hiring and empowering and funding diverse voices behind the camera as well, not just putting like a black character, you know, one black character in a show and thinking that's gotten the job done.
I also want to ask you, Aisha, about an appearance that you made on the show, Whose Line Is It Anyway? It's a clip of you and Wayne Brady calling out racism on the show. Let's watch this.
Man, can you pick out the man that robbed you? Number two.
Y'all know that's up, right?
Sir, can you pick out the man that embezzled hundreds of millions of dollars from the American economy and then made you pay for it?
You mean after systematically devaluing my education and relegating me to certain neighborhoods, whereas I couldn't actually pursue the education that would enable me to rise to meet a certain fiscal stature in this country?
And also preventing you from making any loans for homes or jobs or businesses or getting a car lease.
You were the host of the show, and I wonder, looking back now on that moment, I don't know, maybe you can even tell us, as the initial sort of improv skit there played out, you know, what did that feel like? And how does this look now, looking back on it?
Well, it's interesting. There's been a lot of dialogue about this online because Wayne posted it and, you know, it fell into my timeline. And I want to point out that at the time and even now, what I took that joke to be was a comment on the way that police skew these kinds of situations against black people, that they literally lined up three people and they, you know, obviously the two white guys didn't resemble the black guy, and the cops were obviously trying to gear the entire system towards convicting a black guy with no evidence. That was how I took that joke. And, but I did want to come out and, you know, kind of like, you know, reset the apple cart, upright the apple cart here, in case people were taking it the other way, which is the way I think a lot of people have taken it, which is that, you know, black people are always the criminal here. I mean, I think now with this joke, you know, kind of back in the ether, it's a part of a larger conversation, which is that a lot of the time, you know, police pick a black guy, decide that he's the criminal, and then skew the entire judicial system, the justice system, the police system against that person. We've seen it so many times that, I mean, they're countless. And I think even with the Ahmaud Arbery shooting, what you saw was, you know, some guys that said, well, I just knew by looking at him, he was a criminal. And I think that skit really pointed to that constant ongoing fundamental prejudice in our culture that if there's a black guy around, he's got to be the bad guy. And then turning it on its head and saying, look, we can point to people who have done, you know, much worse in our culture and really undermine the American economy over and over and over again, and they seem to keep getting a pass.
Yeah, it does make more sense when you explain it with the idea of the fix was in, obviously, in a lineup there as people were trafficking in stereotypes, right? So, Aisha Tyler, thank you so much for coming on, joining us from Los Angeles. We're very thankful to have you on for this discussion.
It was a pleasure. Thanks for having me.